Hey, I'm Brian Vann, SportbikeTrackGear.com, and today I'm going to show you what it takes to fix a crashed race bike in the heat of the moment while you're at the track, whether you're racing or doing track days. Okay. Last weekend, Max and I were at the 47th WIRA GNF, Grand National Finals. Max was doing a whole bunch of racing on the Ninja 400 as well as the STG R3. Unfortunately, and a little out of character for Max Fan, we had two crashes on the Ninja, one in the wet and one in the dry in his very last race. That was a pretty fast one. That was probably about a 70 mile an hour-ish low side. We're gonna show the crash footage from that in this video. The bike received some damage. We were done for the day, so I just loaded it up. And we're gonna show you in this video what the bike looked like before I did anything to it. But what I decided to do as we were going through this process of cleaning it up and getting it ready to be repaired, instead of just simply making the bike perfect again, I wanted to show you all exactly what I would do if I were still at the racetrack and we had more track time in front of us, whether it's track days or it's racing. What would I do to get this bike in a state where it's safe to ride? That is paramount. My kid's on this bike. It's super important to me the bike is safe for him to ride. There's enough danger in the sport itself. I don't want to do anything that adds to that for him. And I'm sure you wouldn't want to do anything that adds to that for yourself. And at the end of the day, you also want to get the motorcycle to a respectable spot to where it still looks good. If the bike looks like shit, you're not going to feel great about riding it. That's just a reality. Any one of us, I think, for the most part, is going to feel that way, right? So take a little pride in the repair that you're making. Get duct tape that is in a similar color to the paint scheme you have of your bike. So you need a few rolls of duct tape. And make sure you're going to the racetrack with spare parts. Spare foot pegs, toe pieces, spare clip-ons, right? So you're able to take a simple low side like we had here and within a very small window of time, get this bike race ready again. I'm going to fix this bike like we have more races later in the day or more races the next day. And I'm going to show you exactly what we would do trackside to make that happen. So the end result will be a bike that is completely ready to pass technical inspection, safe to ride and race, of course, and look good enough that in pictures from 20 feet away, it's going to look amazing. We're going to use very simple things to do that. You're going to see with this lightweight bike and the damage from this crash, it's relatively easy to do. I've already gotten it all cleaned up. Trackside, what would you do to that? The same thing that I did here. I got out a garden hose, sprayed everything off. I did take some time to scrub it real quickly. Trackside, would I do that if I was in a hurry to get the bike, you know, fixed and re-teched? Probably wouldn't go as far as to use soap, but still you need a water source to rinse it all off. We're gonna begin up here with the clip-on tube. We really need to have this replaced. It makes it a lot easier to move the bike around, and obviously you have to have that repaired in order to ride and race the bike. You can see here, this is the Woodcraft clip-on assembly. It literally broke and bent right at the clip-on cuff. Something that I do with all of my race bikes. Once I get the controls in a position where ergonomically the rider is happy with it, I like to put a mark on the upper triple clamp, okay, with a self-centering punch. That gives me a reference point that I can very quickly go back to when I have the bike disassembled, or in a situation like this, I can look at it to see if the cuff had even twisted. And in this case, it is still right where I would have put it before, so the cuff didn't even twist. That's a good sign. That's an indicator the front end is not going to be twisted. Something else that I really look for when it comes to front end twist and damage, and we're talking about the relationship between the upper triple clamp, the lower triple clamp, and of course the fork tubes, is going to be damage to the steering stops down here on the bike. I have the K-Tech steering damper on this that requires you to basically drill through the steering stop and put in these fasteners here, which shortens up the available sweep of the bars. Looking down here, neither one of those is cracked off. I do see just a little, I can feel a little ding in that metal that is welded to the steering head of the bike, the steering stop from the factory, but there is no significant damage in that area. To be fair, something I was kind of concerned about when I installed the K-Tech damper was if I had weakened that steering stop on the lower triple clamp by drilling through it. And clearly this shows, because this isn't the first bar I put on it now, this is the second bar on the same side, because minivan crashed two times in this bike, unfortunately the GNF on the right side. Okay, so I look at that, that's good. I look at this, this is not rotated. So we're going to continue our disassembly over here. We need to get the master cylinder off. You know, and something I recommend too, even if, let's say you're in a race situation where you have one race in between, right? Don't hurry when you try to get the bike put back together. That's when you really want to kind of slow things down. We had a scenario like that at the GNF where myself, Jimmy Fox, and Dave Babel, we're all working on Max's bike. And I'm the crew chief, he's my son, so I kind of lead the way. And what I did is I really just slowed things down. I move deliberately, I make sure that every step that you take, every motion that you make has purpose, but you never want to rush, because it's really important that when you're done with the motorcycle, it's going to be safe for yourself or your rider to take back on track. Okay, master cylinder's loosened up. We need to get start-stop switch. Then of course, the throttle assembly. Motion Pro Rev 2. We did not even lose a brake lever. We got the CRG levers on this bike right now. Okay, we did not lose a brake lever on this bike because the Driven Racing Track Day lever guard that we had on here, that thing has been crashed on twice over the weekend. And no damage to the throttle tube, no damage to the brake lever. And I gotta tell you, that in itself is pretty damn impressive. Got to break this loose. Get that out of the tube. there's basically two halves. I'll show you once we get this apart, how this is assembled. You can get these pieces out of here. Two wedges out, I'll show you what those look like. And what happens is they literally wedge themselves inside the bar, and it creates that situation, just makes it kind of difficult to get them out. Okay, now the bar, we need to remove the bar end because we're not going to be using it due to the fact that we do have a lever guard installed. So we'll go ahead and pull the bar end out. As you can see, that's held in there pretty well. We'll save that. You never know when you have a little crash another time with a bar that is using a bar end and that's all you damage. You can go ahead and pop that back in, okay? But we need the tube hollow on this end so we're able to get the lever guard installed. Okay, bar ends out. I took the switch pod apart, so we've got the two halves separated. I've got the clamp off of the brake master cylinder, and now we're ready to go ahead and slide the bar into the clip-on cuff. Go ahead and slide it into the throttle. I did not take the throttle assembly apart, okay? Don't feel the need to really do that. The bar we can go ahead and snug up right now. Get that lined up same as I have it here on the other side, right about there. So that way we have equal bar length. And from here we can just build the rest of the controls out. Leave everything loose. It's important with the clamp that goes on the master cylinder that you pay attention to the arrow here that indicates which side goes up. The controls, the hand controls on the bike, the foot controls on the bike, those are areas where you just can't make mistakes. Everything has to be done correctly so that the motorcycle is safe to operate. Okay, so let's go ahead and get that switch pod. Together there, the screws. You're still able to move that a little bit. It's just held on there with friction. There's like a little rubber grommet that's in there that holds that in place. So there is still some wiggle room to work with there. Master cylinder a little more inboard, lined up. Okay, throttle's gonna go right about there. Kind of work the grease in that you put back there. Got our lever guard. Let's go and get all the pieces put together here. It's really snug fit into this bar. Work its way in there. With the master cylinder, you want to tighten the upper bolt first. Tighten that all the way. That's going to remove any gap between the clamp and the upper mount of the master cylinder. All the torque for this is done using the lower bolt. It's really important that you do it that way. We find the angle that my rider likes. Okay, and it is right about there. We also like the brake lever to be in a little bit. where Max likes it. Go ahead and snug the lower one. Make sure the brake lever guard is aligned. We have this torqued all the way so it's not going to move on track. Okay, that looks good. Sweep the bars back and forth, make sure everything moves freely, there's no throttle binding. That all looks good. Another important point here is that front banjo bolt. Anytime you have clip-on damage, something that I like to check is to make sure this front banjo bolt up here at the master, okay, hasn't lost any torque. And in this case, it's not lost any torque. That is good to go. So we have our hand controls all reassembled and good. Once I have the rest of the motorcycle put back together and we're able to ride it, I'll make sure the bars are straight by taking it for a short ride in the paddock or the parking lot, okay? That is that last opportunity to really verify you have no misalignment here in the front. Okay, now we'll tackle the rear set. The peg has been shortened a bit, all right? I'll give you an idea of how much. There's a lot of riders, they would simply just leave these two pieces on here. For our purpose today, we're gonna go ahead and replace those. You know, you wanna make sure your rider's as comfortable as possible too, and oftentimes shortening up the foot pegs doesn't necessarily make somebody feel better about being on the bike, okay? So we'll go ahead and replace these two pieces now. Vortex really did a great job with this new design rear set. It makes replacing the pegs and the toe pieces a pretty simple operation. For the toe pieces, you need to pull out the fastener all the way. That lined up, torque that down. Now to get the foot peg off, you can clearly see now the hole here, right, is it's blind now. I mean, it's kind of got some aluminum pushed over it and you have that plastic plug that comes in the center. You need to be able to deal with that. That's how you do that. And now I need to get a six T handle. You know, and every rider is different. Some riders, they're like, the whole foot peg thing, they're not gonna say a word about it. You know, just leave it short. I can tell you right now, my little buddy wants a brand new foot peg on there each time. And when I put his bike together, it's always my goal to make him feel as comfortable as possible. Comfortable helps you go faster, comfortable helps you be safer. So for this video, we'll go ahead and replace the peg. You're welcome for this little tidbit. That is a pretty handy little tip I just showed you right there. All that is, that's just a wood screw. Right, you screw right through the center of it and it literally pulls it right out. And I've seen people waste half a day trying to fish that out of there, okay? Just all you need is one wood screw and a cordless drill and you are good to go. Now there's our rear set, okay? While we're over here, obviously double check everything, make sure we don't have any other damage. You know, it doesn't even look like it really even rotated in this bracket at all. There's a bracket that's an extension of the frame on the Ninja 400. It spans from here to here, and those are shown to be fairly fragile. I've had to straighten the one on the other side already from the crash that I had on this bike, but in this case, that one looks to be good to go right now. Now we have to deal with the exhaust. It's hard to see from the angle that Caleb has right now. I haven't pulled the camera off, so I'll wait a second. You can see the exhaust canister, it's simply pushed in. Okay, when he fell on the bike, when we got lucky, it didn't really get scraped up at all, right? But the bracket up here got pushed in, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna brace myself here, and well, it looks pretty damn good, doesn't it? Okay, tail section. Clearly this piece is pretty beat up, all right? Long term, am I gonna keep this? Negative, this is getting thrown out. But worth a try, right? We wanna get back out there. We've got races we're paid for. Our rider is up and okay, right? Just made a simple mistake, you know? And we wanna be back out there, so we're gonna fix it. I highly recommend having multiple colors of duct tape in your toolbox, ready to go. Closer they match your bodywork and your livery, the better off you are gonna be. In our case, we've got blue, we've got white, we've got yellow, right? We have all the colors that we need to keep our bikes in a reasonable state of repair. So I'll just go ahead and get this piece put back together the best that you can. You want to make sure too that what you're doing is going to stay together while you're out there on track. You know, you don't want to have stuff just blown apart while you're out there. If you take it over to tech inspection and it looks super half-ass, they're not going to pass you. Okay, you're not going to get an opportunity to go back out. I'll probably reinforce this on the back side as well. But just to give you an idea of what we're doing here, pretty simple. We are missing part of the tail section. That's really, you know, to get you back on track. This little ear is not a big deal. Yeah, I'm gonna grab a piece and just reinforce the inside real quickly too. Okay, the repairs are done. We're ready for WIRA Race Tech, and I can promise you this bad boy is going to pass. It's also gonna look really good in all of the race pictures. So if we were still at the track right now and there were races today, okay, we would be able to get out there and finish our weekend. That is one of the magic things with these lightweight bikes that I've discovered, is that when they fall, the damage is typically very, very slight. The operating cost of these things is so low compared to the bigger bikes. They're easier on tires. They use hardly any fuel. And in crashes, they seem to come out relatively unscathed. With this bike, all that I did to get it in the shape that you see right now, replace a toe piece, replace a foot pin. I pulled pretty hard on this bracket. Replaced a clip-on tube. Applied a little duct tape, used a garden hose, replaced one STG sticker, couple of zip ties, used a little Sharpie on that lever guard there, made that look a little bit better. And now we've got a bike that's safe to ride, looks good, and will easily pass tech inspection. What did I have invested in these quick repairs? Probably about $30 to $40 tops. If you're gonna take your kid racing or you're gonna take yourself racing, lightweight bike or bigger bike, make sure you've got spares with you at the racetrack. And also, whatever paint scheme you have, purchase rolls of duct tape that are close in color to your paint scheme. And that just really helps you get the motorcycle back together in a way where it's track worthy. And it'll look good. If you happen to get back out there and you're getting it done, you get some great pictures, the bike's gonna look good in the pictures. And the reality is any rider feels better about the bike when they're on it if the bike looks good. I would say this bike looks pretty damn good considering it got crashed twice and there was a small electrical fire. We'll talk about that later. That's a whole different story. There was a little electrical fire that we also dealt with at the 47th WIRA GNF.